When you speak, confusion fades. Just a word, and suddenly I'm not afraid. 'Cause you speak, and freedom reigns. There is hope, in every single word you say.
Holy Father, I just thank you for your presence always. Thank you for your word that is truly alive, it's active. And I thank you, Lord, that you are the truth, you are the way, and you are the life, and you are the only way to the Father, Lord Jesus. And I thank you, Lord, that these truths are just going deeper and deeper in us, setting us free in every area of our lives, Lord. So I ask you, Holy Spirit, to come and fill our hearts, fill this time, draw us closer to you, Lord, and may you open our eyes to these spiritual truths so that we will behold the wonderful things of your glorious word. And it's in your name, Lord Jesus, I pray. Amen. We recently reviewed the book of Ephesians on the chapters previously, and they were all covered who we are in Christ, how to live it out, and now how to operate in these truths. And Paul laid this solid foundation for us. And so in these teachings from Ephesians 6, 10 through 19, we're going to learn how to be armed and with this equipment that God has given us, the armor of God. And it's always readily available for us, and so that we are to clothe ourselves. We'll talk more about that in a few minutes. And it's so we won't be caught off guard, that the enemy will be exposed and we will not be defeated. And so as we move forward in this study, we're going to get to understand, we've gotten some good understanding also of who our enemy is, but we're going to get more understanding of how to walk out the victory that has already been given us. Because the enemy comes filled with lies. He has no truth in him. He desires to kill, steal, and destroy, but God came in the flesh, Jesus Christ. He came forth in the fullness of God, and he brought forth that victory for us. So we don't have to operate for victory. We operate out of the victory he's given us. So Paul's built us so far on this foundation, who we are in Christ, that we're hidden in Jesus, that he's our Savior, our Redeemer, our Protector, and our Defender. And he's truly everything that we need. We lack no good thing. In our last studies, we looked at verses 10 and 11. And finally, it says, in verse 10, it says, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his power and his might. Put on the full armor of God so that we can take a stand against the schemes of the enemy." The devil. Paul is stating here, in conclusion of all the revelation that has been given, of who we are in Christ, the foundation that he laid out for us, how to walk out our lives in righteousness, he's concluding here, be strong in the Lord and be covered in the full armor of God. So our last studies, we learned who our enemy is. We've learned now how our battle consists of the enemy, the devil, our flesh, and the world. And we looked at each one of how our enemy, we looked at each one and how they are our enemy, the world, the flesh, and the devil. And we've also learned how to recognize these enemies against us. So again, if you've missed those teachings, go back to my website, go back to YouTube, and feel free to watch them. The word helps us to see and to remember that our fight is not against flesh and blood, but it's against principalities. And our battle is not physical, but it's spiritual. We know where our help comes from though, right? Jesus, God, the Holy Spirit. And as believers, we have the Holy Spirit to lead us and guide us and to teach us into all truth. And it's hard to remember that when we're in the midst of circumstances. And it can be a struggle. But God, who is our ever-present help in times of trouble, he leads us into victory. He guides us so that we can grow and that we can discern these struggles and be strengthened in them to be strong and courageous. And to even get a greater freedom. Jesus is our chief commander. And in the natural, a soldier knows his enemy. So we won't be taken by surprise. The same is true in the spiritual. The Lord has given us all that we need and has fully equipped us with all his power and how to operate from it. So last week, that's what was our study in verses 10 and 11. We studied that be strong in the Lord. And then we looked up the word strong in Greek Strong's concordance. And it found that it means to be filled with, to be strengthened, filled with power, empowered. So this is God's divine power given to us through the Holy Spirit to operate from. In 2 Timothy 2:1, it says, "And therefore, my child, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus." His grace is not only our divine favor, his grace is also our divine power, and it's divinely powerful. And we find it in him through our times of intimacy, through prayer, reading his word, communing with him constantly throughout the day, drawing continually from his well of unending grace, empowering us in our thoughts, through our will, our emotions, and what we need in our everyday life. For without him, we really truly can do nothing. We can have our own strength. We can have our own might, but it only goes so far. It frizzles out very quickly. And so it's a good gauge for me to know that I'm in my flesh. Weariness and frustrations enter in my circumstances. They seem more powerful. We gain our strength in Jesus alone, and he births forth strength from glory to glory in us, strength upon strength. And it's through his word, it's by his spirit, through prayer, knowing that he's good. And his goodness is always in the midst of our trials. And knowing he is fighting our battles for us. Truly, our victory is in him. The first chapter of Ephesians shows us that we are blessed with every spiritual blessing in Christ Jesus. We're seated in heavenly places with Christ, blessed with the understanding that we are chosen and we're dearly loved and we're sealed with the promise of the Holy Spirit. So in verse 11, it says to put on the full armor of God, for his precepts are like a splendid armor of a heavily armed soldier, so that we may be able to successfully stand against all the schemes and the strategies and the deceits of the devil. So now we're going to go to verse 12. Verse 12 says, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but it's against the rulers and against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realm." The struggle that we're wrestling in or with, we find ourselves in not only against, it's not against the people in our lives, although it can feel like that a lot of the times. J.B. Phillips' version states it this way: our fight is not against any physical enemy. Okay, so it's not your husband or your wife or your children or your grandchildren or your boss or your neighbor. They're not your enemy. As Christ followers, we're in a war, one that is not physical, but very spiritual. And our wrestle, Paul writes, is against principalities. And these principalities are powers, which are spirits of a hierarchy. They're fallen angels. They're demons under the leadership of Satan. Paul continues to write, against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this world, the unseen world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. These rulers are called principalities, powers, authorities, dominions. They have various rankings of evil spirits. This is where the real warfare lies, okay? In the realm of the spirit, fighting these spiritual battles. We see this happening in the book of Daniel. When he was praying for 21 days, the angel appeared before him It says in Daniel 10, verses 12 through 13, "Don't be afraid, Daniel," he said, "for from the first day that you proposed to understand and to humble yourself before God, your words were heard, and I have come in response to them. However," verse 13, "the prince of the power of Persia opposed me for 21 days. Then Michael, one of the chief princes, came to me, for I have been left there with the king of Persia." So you can see there's a very strong battle warring in the spirit realm. We see it in 2 Kings 6:16 and 17 as well, where Elijah's servant was afraid, and Elijah prayed to the Lord to open his servant's eyes, so that he would see more of the heavenly host than the enemy that was about to attack them. It says, "Do not be afraid." Interesting. And Jesus said that a lot. Don't fear. Elijah answered, "For those who are with us are more than those who are with them." Then Elijah prayed, "Oh Lord, please open his eyes that he may see." And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw that the hills were full of horses and chariots of fire all around them. Have you ever noticed that both these passages, and I just spoke it, and it encourages us, again, not to be afraid, okay? Because Jesus constantly, throughout the New Testament, and also many of the writings of the apostles, state, don't be afraid. Our weapons are a spiritual weapon, okay? They're mighty in God. It's a spiritual battle. It cannot be fought with physical weapons. 2 Corinthians 10, verses 3 and 4, it states, "For though we live in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not fleshly," they're not carnal, "but they're divinely powerful towards the demolishing of strongholds." In Revelation 12, 7 through 8, we can see the end of the battle drawing near. It says, "Then a war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back." Verse 8 says, "But the dragon was not strong enough, and no longer was any place found in heaven for him or his angels." Satan is a defeated foe. And though through the power of the cross and the resurrection, he has been defeated, the power and the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Even though he is a defeated foe, the war is still raging. Satan is trying to keep man in captivity, in sin, with temptations. He's attempting to be the supreme ruler through deceptions, and he entices his people with the temptation of through the flesh, through the lust, causing sinful living. He wages a battle for our heart, for our minds, for our souls, our spirit. He strategizes and he directs. His strategies are directed at God, at his plan, and his people. Satan, it says in the scriptures, is a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. He studies human weaknesses, and he afflicts the soul as believers whose spirit rightfully belongs to God. But we are not our own. We've been purchased, and we have been brought into the kingdom of our glorious Savior. And he has purchased us with his blood. He has translated us from the kingdom of darkness into his glorious light. And the Lord has given us spiritual weapons. He didn't leave us here unequipped. We are to suit up. We have to take up this whole armor of God, that we might be able to stand in these evil days, and having done all, it says to stand. Which brings us to verse 13 in Ephesians 6. It says, "Therefore take up the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you will be able to stand your ground and having done everything to stand. Some translations will say put on, meaning in the word Greek 1746 is enduo, means clothe. It's a sense of sinking into a garment. How do we put on this armor? It's a good question. This is a scripture that empowers it. Well, I'm going to go back a second. A cross reference I had to go to. How to put on this armor for putting on, clothe ourselves, is found in Luke 24:49. It says, where you were clothed with power, which this scripture talks about the empowering of the promise of the Holy Spirit. Okay, it says, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you, but remain in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. So the word enduo is the clothing of the empowering of that's the equipment, putting it on. The armor is not a suggestion. It's really a command. A command to clothe ourselves, to put on. We have to choose, okay, to set our hearts to that command. We are to choose to align ourselves under our chief commander and his protection, because he's the Almighty. Because this is his armor. It's the armor of God from Jesus himself, our very source. Our protection, our defense. And just as we draw from the Lord in our lives, in him, he clothes us and he empowers us with the power of the Holy Spirit. This spiritual power is from God, equipped with every piece of the armor. It's our royal war robe, is the way I like to look at it, because it's We're royalty. We are righteous in Christ, and he is covered us completely. We received this armor as believers, not because of anything we've earned or anything that we can do, but in this armor, whatever attacks us has to go through the sovereign Lord's hands. Not only does Jesus cover us with himself, at conversion, we became one with him. So clothed in his garment is his royal armor. He's covered us. We are not only protected, but we are united with him. We entered into this relationship with the living God, Jesus Christ, and we are secure in this new set of clothing. By our lifestyles, our oneness, an ever-deepening relationship with him. Through growing in him, we become stronger. We become rooted and grounded in him to stand. At least for me, that's been my experience. I know he's always with me. He's always for me. But as I grow closer to him, God reveals himself to me, to you, as you grow closer to him through his word. He makes it more alive in us by his spirit. He affirms us that all that he is to us, everything about him, everything, all scriptures lead to Jesus. So everything points to him, even this armor. Even the armor, he's our sovereign Lord. He's our all-powerful King who reigns over all, including the principalities and the powers of Satan. So that when that day of evil does come, and it's here now, every day, we see it all around us, we are strong in the Lord, in his armor, and we can stand. So, in the word stand, Greek 4:36, it means to take a stand against. It means oppose, resist, take complete stand. It means to be established in a position, holding your ground, refusing to be moved, and even push back. We stand strong in our armor by refusing to be moved, by knowing and also by living out these truths that we're blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places, that we stand knowing that we're chosen and dearly loved and adopted into His family. We stand on the promises of God that they are all yes and amen in Christ Jesus. We stand knowing that nothing will separate us from the love of God. We stand knowing that we, who we are in Christ. We stand by standing still sometimes, knowing that the Lord will fight for us, that we only need to be still and know that He's God. We stand by staying humble before Him and resisting the devil, and he will flee. We stand by walking not in the flesh, but by walking with the Holy Spirit. We stand through the communion with God, worshiping Him in spirit and in truth. We stand by praying and giving thanks in all things. We stand by speaking His word of truth in the face of deception. We stand by putting on Jesus, putting on the armor of light, putting on kindness, putting on love. And in this work or labor in which we were created for, to do good works, we stand, which will never be in vain. We stand all the more as the days are evil, and they are strongly approaching and are now here. We need to stand now more than ever, to stand against the arguments that are rising against the Word of God. The stand in the second part of this verse, this and stand more in verse 13, it's a different Greek word. And from that word, it talks about to, the first one was resist, but this one is to have a cause to stand. To stand firm, to be steadfast, to stand ready, to uphold and sustain the authority. So this is like a, okay, you're going to resist and you're going to stay there and you're going to take authority over it, kind of sense that I get from it. So therefore, take up the full armor of God so that you will be able to resist in the evil day, stand. And having done everything, stand firm. That's what I feel like it's saying. The time is now begun. Ephesians 6, 5:16, it says, redeeming this time now, because the days are evil. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might, trusting in our leader, King Jesus, and the equipment that He has provided for us. This was a short study, and it's probably going to be even little blips in the next few studies, because I'm going to take these a little bit slow, I think, break down every part of the armor, and piece by piece as the Holy Spirit leads me and to teach, and I feel like He's breaking it down little by little so we can really take hold of it, and let the Holy Spirit teach you and guide you what He wants for you personally. So we're going to learn how to apply these truths even more deeper in our daily, in our lives, and how to walk them out in our daily lives. Okay? Thanks for joining me. Let's pray. Thank you, Father. I thank you that your word is true, and thank you for your protection. I thank you, Lord, that we can rest in you. And that's a way of standing as well. And I thank you, Lord, that you are our peace. You are the calm in every storm. And Lord, I thank you that we can seek your kingdom first and your righteousness, and everything is added. So thank you, Lord, for this time, even though it was short. I ask you, Lord, to take these two verses and make them more permanent in us, Lord. Make them just permeate our being with understanding and revelation of what it is truly about the armor, that we are truly hidden in you, and that it's not just words on paper, but we are actually in the spirit realm, sitting in heavenly places, hidden in you. And Lord, I just thank you that you are bringing it deeper in us, renewing our hearts, renewing our minds. And Lord, I thank you for your protection. Continue to guide us, Lord. And I praise you and thank you.
When you speak, confusion fades. Just a word, and suddenly I'm not afraid, 'cause you speak and freedom reigns. There is hope in every single word you say. I don't wanna miss one. So quiet my heart, I'm listening.
Open arms, I see him running. I see my father's open arms, bearing my shame, wearing my scars. I see him running. I see my father's open arms.